and Iphigenia Dissa. Very interesting story. Okay. We have done it once for print on online. This is about Orshata. Tell us the Orshata story, ma'am.
Well, when I was growing up, yeah, used to have a lot of Orshata from the Quailers. And it went out of production. And that taste still remained in my palate. And I wanted to have, and there was nobody producing it. So I decided to try. It's an almond drink. So I decided to...
Almond milk and what? Almond milk and?
Almond. Almonds and sugar. And maybe cashew nuts also to supplement it. And well, it was a trial and error from some...
The recipe was lost, you said?
Ah, I never had a recipe.
Okay. So you just went by taste and you recreated the recipe?
Yes. And then, of course, I used my brother as a guinea pig. I kept on giving it to him. He said, does it taste like that? Does it taste like that?
So you rediscovered, this lost recipe. But let me say one thing. We were asking on the net and we didn't know what we were talking about. And I didn't even taste it as a young kid. But when you said, I have the recipe, and you said something, everyone responded. And there was an outflowing of emotion over this drink called Orshata.
Yes, because we grew up with it and it was very, very popular.
Yeah.
And for weddings, if you gave that, means it was...
Class.
So because Orshata was a drink made with almonds. Now, almonds is not a very cheaply available nut. It's quite an expensive nut.
Yeah.
And this drink is specifically made out of almond concentrate.
Yeah.
So in order to be able to afford an almond concentrate
in those days, especially
in those days, was a sense of
luxury.
So what people would do is people would sort of, you know, only people belonging to the affluent families would kind of serve it
as a status marker,
just like how today if someone serves a black what do you call that? Double black or a black label or something like that. The status of the family is always different compared to someone who would serve something different compared to that.
So, Mrs. Dissa, you were saying like you last had it when and you lost sight of it from when to when?
Maybe I had some 45 to 50 years back.
Okay.
Now you want to ask me my age.
No. I'm not going to work backwards. Don't worry.
Anyway, so from then on, maybe it took me about 3-5 years to get the right flavor till I was satisfied.
Now you are marketing it at a small level with the help from your daughter-in-law?
Yes. Very small. Family and friends usually.
So
I do not use preservatives.
Okay.
So it has a very short... Shelf life. And so when somebody orders, I make it fresh. And
what is your output now per month?
It's a made to order.
Okay,
basis.
Made to order.
Because the thing is, we cannot really commit to a production in advance.
Yeah.
Because Mama's selling point here is no preservatives.
Okay.
It's mainly for anyone and everyone who would like to enjoy the drink. However, the drink, the concentrate, has got a shelf life of about 15 days in the refrigerator.
Okay.
So the concentrate can be used for 15 days, sometimes even more if the weather around is conducive. And of course, if the drink was immediately kept in the refrigerator after you took it home from us, you know. So
it is only a Goan drink, it's not even in Portugal?
Portugal, influence of the Portuguese, that is the time.
No, but is it available there? Is it a drink there also? Or is it something that evolved here? From the
well, that is something
that's not found now, but
there is a Mexican variety.
I see. Yeah,
there's a Mexican
variety. Yeah. With the same name.
With rice and
Orshata.
And that's made with rice and some other, and cinnamon and some spices like that.
How would you describe the taste?
Nowhere close to this.
No. How would you describe our taste? Our Orshata, Goan Orshata.
Is a smooth and very pleasant, creamy. So if you have, say, 15 or 20 ml of Orshata syrup with that amount of milk and a lot of ice and water, it tastes superb, really. And it is quite...
Rich and filling?
Rich, filling, and I started selling it only to first two students, thinking that, you know, that's something they could have with the milk.
Yeah.
And they would love their milk.
Yeah.
And so they would go off the fizzy drinks. And so that's why no preservatives, okay. Safe for children.
Okay. I remember you saying that you wanted also to use it to get children to like their milk.
Yes, exactly. That's why I said. If they put it in their milk and have, it's really lovely.
Anything else that we have lost in terms of food from the pre-61 era?
Yeah, like how, you know, there was some 4 or 5 years back, people were calling me and saying, take our Binna, it's falling, nothing is happening. And that's how I started.
Binna?
Yeah, I started with this kokum syrup. Because there was always, there were people making, but with essence.
Okay.
The cardamom or jeera essence or something. Which was not the
taste
that we were used to. So this is plain Brindavan without any of this. So I started making that too. And Ampanna, of course, because mangoes fall and I don't like them being wasted.
If you don't mind me asking, one recipe of anything, maybe not a commercial one, or something that you'd like to share, which people have forgotten in Goa now maybe.
Yes, like Ampanna. I would use, it's very good for health and for the heat. At that time, you get a lot of heat. So, I put Ampanna.
Yeah. Baby, come.
Raw mango, jeera, yeah. Ginger, and sugar. So, salt. Rock salt. So, it becomes very good for the health and for the heat at that time.
And young lady, what's your experience with Indo-Portuguese food?
Been a pleasant one, a refreshing one.
Yeah.
And so I was not the kind of person who, you know, used to eat a lot of sweet things. I don't actually have a palate for sweet. But once I got married and came into the Disa family. It wasn't long till I was inducted into the sweet tooth. So the Orshata became my favorite because I started having the one that Mama used to make. And it was very easy for me to kind of market it and sell it, especially during the COVID time, was because I enjoyed the drink.
Yeah.
So the kind of faith that I had in the drink was very easy for me to
pass it on.
Emulate to the people, because you know, when you know that something is good, you can definitely tell them, you know, I give you the guarantee that it is something that you will never ever find anywhere else. So
confidence. So,
yes, absolutely. And it is something that you will probably never be able to taste anywhere else. It's been a very, very nice experience. So yeah, so especially when I had both my babies, everyone says almonds and things like that is something that pregnant mothers and mothers who are nursing their babies need to consume. So I had that in abundance without even thinking about it. So.
And what's your experience with marketing it? It rings a bell.
We had a bumper during COVID.
I see.
We had a bumper, of course, thanks to your website.
No, that was videos.
We did really well on the page on Facebook. Yeah.
So, no, you all advertise it well, and I think you all told the story well. And every food item has a story behind it. See, we don't want to just eat; we want to know what Louis was telling me about the rice they are going to give us today.
Yeah,
with the flavor of the earth after the first. So.
So this has been it wasn't very
not difficult.
Absolutely not, because like I said, it's very easy to sell something that you enjoy and you have faith in.
They come and pick it up from your place or something?
During COVID we used to go and deliver it to their doors, but today we request people to come over and pick up. But for any reason, if it's not possible within about the Panjim market area is up until where we can deliver, because because it's a bit inconvenient for my father-in-law for us to kind of go beyond that.
Some contact number or something?
Number 98504-5157.
5157. So nice. All the very best. Keep up the work.
Thank you.
Good
very
work.
Much.